Welcome from sunny California to another very interesting and compelling video. I try to say what is really compelling to me, and since we're just smack dab in the middle of the most compelling time in history, it's pretty easy. It's pretty easy, right? Now, if you get off track, just get right back on track. I've been a little off track recently, just under tremendous stress. I mean, obviously, the March 23rd, today's, I believe, the 23rd, or not the 24th, it's the 24th. Well, the 23rd is you know, the aftershock of troubles in the world, which we pointed out would be 23rd is one of the, a crucial date. And then the people are realizing, hey, wow. People I talk to, they say it's just already, it's already like the sinkhole is collapsing. There's the metaphorically, we can say the world's like a sinkhole, a spiritual sinkhole. We've sabotaged our spiritual will here, that on the surface things seem fine, but underneath there's this huge sinkhole, and suddenly the surface just collapses and disappears down that sinkhole. This is exactly what's going to happen. To use a metaphor, the sinkhole, well, it's like a spiritual sinkhole here. And sinkholes happen just like boom, like that, so fast, don't they? And they kind of grow and grow and grow and grow, and everything just gets sucked into these huge sinkholes. There's sinkholes appearing all over the world, actually. This is a metaphor for our mental condition, our mental condition. So we want to get as far away from the edge of that sinkhole as possible. And that's what we're doing here. So we have various techniques here. Skillful means. We have very skillful means here. Very skillful. Backburning is one of them. You should know what backburning is. It's something that you feel you're most vulnerable to. The yoga girl culture is the culture of making the superficial attractive. To tell you the very direct truth is, most people who are into spirituality are doing it to try to avoid realization, not to gain it, but to avoid it, to pay the price of avoidance. Pay the price of avoidance. They think if they just put in the time and learn some lingo and do enough, that price symbol, they'll say, "Hey God, I've paid enough price to delay it or to avoid it." It's too scary, because the continuity fear makes it very scary. Absurdity claims it's an abyss is waiting for us, which is totally absurd. So that the yoga girl culture is a culture that is trying to make superficial spirituality very attractive. But that superficial spirituality is designed to avoid real true depth spirituality, the real recognitions. That's what it's actually designed for. To purchase a ticket away from that. Say, "Oh, I'm doing enough. You know, I'm doing my yoga. I'm doing breathing. So you know, that's good enough. And so I don't have to look at that stuff. That I've got an exemption from that." It's like trying to earn an exemption or an excuse. "Yeah, I'm doing God. I'm come on, don't bother me. I'm into it." But they're into this to just keeping the superficial very attractive. Most spirituality on this planet is entirely superficial. Entirely superficial. The vast majority of it. And the idea is, if we just stay fixated on the superficial, we never go and take a look at the depths of what we really need to look at. The real non-dual perspective, right? We don't really get into that. We avoid it. We might have shop talk about it, except, but we don't actually glimpse it and see it and work on abidance in the real spiritual path. We avoid at all costs. We avoid it. This is a fact about this world. So the yoga girl culture means the culture of making superficial spirituality look very attractive. That's the worst danger of all in this world, is the idea that you can make all absurdity good. Okay, there's three different standpoints. There's one that said, let's have everything just absurd. Well, maybe there's two standpoints. One is, let's separate out the good absurdity from the bad absurdity. And the second one is, let's make all absurdity good. That's the yoga girl culture. Let's make all absurdity good. Let's make it all attractive. And that, no problem anymore. We've solved the problem of sorting out the good and the bad absurdity. No, we haven't. Because we've jumped out of the frying pan into the fire. Because now you're fixated on the absurdity as being the base of your being. That this is what's going to give you happiness. It's terrible. It's the worst. It's the worst. That's the worst offense of all. You know, it's like, who's dumber? A dumb idiot or a smart idiot? The smart idiot's dumber. Okay, or dumber, or for sure. Because they say, no, I see a way around my dumb idiocy by doing something, which is even dumber, right? I mean, like, I see a way of doing the impossible. That's the worst position to be in of all, is I think I see a way to do the impossible. Which, how do we leave our intrinsic spaciousness? That's impossible. But so the dumbest of all dumbness is to think that you see a way, you can see a way to do this. Where the other dumbness say, well, I need to do this, but I don't see a way. Yeah, it's kind of real dumb. I don't see a way. And then the even deeper dumbness is say, oh yeah, I know a way. I see a way. And then start drawing all these schematics. Oh, I can do this. That's the worst trap of all. And this is the trap the world is in. It's called outsmarting ourselves. And this ends up in this yoga girl culture, as I call it. I think that the term is very apt. It's very, very much so. Go to these resorts, you know, Costa Rica. Wear all the appropriate, you know, tights and clothing and all this, you know, and be sleek and fit and walk on the beach and walk through the jungle and sit there and listen to the rain in your proper asanas and postures. Meditate, let the calm mind say peace, I am peace, and, you know, do all this stuff and eat macrobiotically and whatever which way, whatever the thing is now, and, you know, go through all the motions. It's all superficial. And there's nothing wrong with it per se, but it's the fixation on it and the making it so attractive, the fixation, which is the trouble, because it's really trying to purchase an exemption from the real work. The real work. The real work is like working in a garbage dump, really. It's tough. It's tough. It's challenging. It's challenging, but it's a tough climb. And the people want to avoid that at all costs. The continuity fear tells them, oh, that's terrible. It's horrible. You hate that. And so most in this world, most spiritual aspirants in this world avoid the real path at all costs. And they're just trying to get an exemption. Said, yeah, it's kind of like, yeah, I went to junior high school. I don't have to go to high school. I know enough. Yeah, so you get this overconfidence, know-it-all attitude of junior high school saying, I don't need high school. No. That's plenty for me. I'm good enough. And, you know, I can do this yoga posture and balance on a rock somewhere. You just say, like, ah, look at me. I'm so cool. I'm so spiritual. This is what's the world is looking at. This is what absurdity sees as helpful. Now, so backburning is one of our skillful techniques, very skillful techniques, because you do not want to be seduced into that yoga girl culture, okay? Otherwise, you're going to be in big trouble, as the world history has always been, and it goes on and on and on. There's many flavors of trouble. So you have to be aware of your vulnerabilities. And you have to address those vulnerabilities where you're in control of addressing them, okay? And you're conscious that you're doing this just to take the edge off the intrigue of, like, hey, I wonder what it'd be like to balance on a rock like that somewhere, you know? Maybe that's enough. You see, maybe that's enough. If I'm just cool enough, you know, and have the right clothing and makeup and complexion and poise and everything. The sunset is right enough and someone photographs me, then maybe that's good enough. We think, you know, maybe I don't need to go through this continuity fear evaporation stress. Well, of course, we do. We do. The only problem there is the continuity fear. It's an extremely bad problem. It's a horrendous problem, actually. We all have it. The good news is that it's treatable. The other option is to try to do the impossible, which is what most are trying to do, and that's not treatable. It's not treatable. So the idea that, you know, someone's not a good, competent teacher because they can't help someone do the impossible is absurd. Nobody can help anyone do the impossible, not even God. So it's absurd. And the problem is we lose our confidence here trying to be teachers just because everyone wants us to help them do the impossible, and we can't do it. They say, you're not very competent. You know, you're not even trying. What's the matter with you? You got no will to do so? No, you can't. It's continuity fear is treatable. That's the only problem we have. It's very treatable, but skillful means are needed. Skillful means. So backburning is one of those skillful means. So I do stuff that helps backburn the situation. Absolutely, I do. For instance, last night I got these cooked beets, and they're already cooked, four of them. And then I put them in with this guava kombucha and pureed them. And then I drank half of it. And let me tell you, that was not very pleasant. The very thought of it right now curdles my stomach. Because beets is like the end thing now. You know, beet juice. I got some beet juice. I haven't tried it yet. You do this stuff so you know that's not it. You know it's not it. You do it anyway. But so you take the edge of the intrigue off so the yoga girl can't come up to you and say, hey, you know, I got some really interesting, you know, I can show you what's it, really, really. I mean, let's just drink beet juice together or something, you know, like that. And like, you know, be just like awesomely in shape and drinking beet juice and let's go on a vacation, you know, let's go do this retreat. I need to do this retreat, yeah. And they have all this stuff there. We're drinking beet juice every night. And you know, so tonight is I'm going to take the rest of that and throw kale in. I'm going to have a beet juice, kombucha, kale smoothie. Okay. Now, am I going to do that every night? No. Okay. But at least I say, yeah, I know what that's about. And that's not it. That's not it. So you spend a lot of time doing what's not it, knowing that it's not it. But still, because of our intrigue, we have a vulnerability to being seduced by yoga girl culture. We most definitely do because of our continuity fear. And so dressing various ways, you know, this idea is if you dress this way, that's it. Maybe that's it. So the yoga culture is very, very seductive in terms of style and fashion and making you think that maybe that's it. There's just an incredible amount of effort and intensity put onto style and fashion in this world and using female models especially to make it seem like, you know, hey, this might be it for you. And you don't have to really do the work on the spiritual path. Just wear this stuff. We're suckers, you know, we keep blaming corporate culture and materialism, but we're suckers for it because of our continuity fear, because our lackadaisical attitude on the path. Lackadaisical attitude will never work. Never work. You must have a very steady determination is what works. That's the only thing that works. That's it. Nothing else works other than steady determination. You can never be lackadaisical. You cannot allow yourself to be lackadaisical. You will definitely fall into the yoga girl cultural trap. You certainly will. And so these styles, it all starts adding up. The food, the styles, the posture, the exercises, the chanting, listening to certain music. You know, it goes on and on and on and on and on, right? And you know, the love goddess thing, it just compounds all that stuff, compounds. The gemstones, the incense. You go to New Age stores, and it's all about yoga girl culture entirely. It didn't used to be. It's amazing what happened. It used to be pretty hard, you know, pretty intense. Some bookstores, New Age bookstores, were a lot of great books, stuff that was really, could be very helpful. And then the cultural shift was just, what's happened is just absolutely amazing. I mean, I don't go in there anymore at all. Rarely I'll go in there just to see how bad it is. And, you know, it's just all yoga girls in there. It's total. The whole yoga girl culture is just, you want to know, it's just there. Completely. All the clothes are for women now. And just tons of clothes. Tons of these accoutrements, you know, accessories, spiritual accessorization. It's all about the spiritual accessorization. It's just fashion. It's just style. It's just fashion. It's superficiality, to say the least. It's just been inundated, utterly taken over by that. So you don't want to get caught by this compoundment of all this stuff, really. And it will snare you. It will, like a fishing lure. The fish goes around, it something catches the fish's eye, and it darts there and, you know, swallows the hook. So what you want to do is you want to make a lure and then hook yourself with it and then unhook. Say, okay, wow, that hurt. And, you know, don't, you know, okay, I've got to make sure I don't get caught by that lure. And that's skillful means. Skillful means. Don't think that we can just, with our mind, just say, no, I'm not interested in this. I can just cut right through that. Cutting through the knot of absurdity requires a tremendously successful spiritual path. And not a lot of us have that. We've just been rocked by the last 50, 60 years, 100 years, you know, we've just been rocked by it. Terribly rocked by it. Let's say the last 100 years have been hell here. You started World War I, started, what, 1914 or something? So let's just say the last 100 years have just been assaulted by our own, by the dance of continuity fear. We really have. And it's brutal. So skillful means are necessary. Really skillful means. So I keep throwing together different combinations of juice stuff and whatever is, you know, some sort of, you think it's like trendy thing. You know, I just ordered some walking sticks. You know, I've never used walking sticks. That's a real trendy thing. Everybody has walking sticks now. It's like, oh yeah, if you have walking sticks, that's it. That's it. You know, oh, you don't have those? Well, of course you're struggling on the spiritual path. Of course you spend all this time. You're having trouble. Are you having trouble? Really? Maybe it's walking sticks. You don't have walking sticks. You know, the cushions, the shock. And you have shock of the wow. Oh, it's kind of, maybe it's the shock of, like, you're on your knees walking down here. You need to get walking sticks and cork. You know, got the cork there and got all this stuff. And that's going to be it. We're so vulnerable to it because we say, oh, now I have to really, you know, listen to Longchenpa. It's so difficult. Oh, it's easier just to buy some walking sticks. This is true. We're suckers for it. And we have to realize we're suckers for it. And be humble enough to realize we truly are suckers. And be intelligent suckers, okay? Be really, really wise, skillful means suckers for it. Take the edge of intrigue off of the culture, okay? Take the edge of intrigue off of it. Wisely, carefully, wisely, within the context of your very serious practice also. That means it takes a lot of time and effort and determination. It certainly does. So I keep working out. I keep doing stuff. I'll keep trying. There's one thing I haven't quite done too much of, but I gotta start trying it probably, you know, work on the core, work on the Pilates ball or something, and just, you know, do the stuff the yoga girls do the stuff, just so you know, okay, this is what it's about, you know, take it or leave it, you know, it's not something you can be seduced with anymore. Cult, absurdity works through seduction. And the yoga girl culture is extraordinarily seductive. It's a very physical culture right now. Extremely physical culture. The fashion, they're going to get into goddess adornment pretty soon, in my opinion. So I may have to look into that. That's got to be careful with that one. Be very careful with that one. That's already building up. Some of these women from the East, the yoga girls from the East, are getting guys hooked and getting culturally. I think the hook is coming where they know how to dress up in these exotic kind of goddess-like get-ups with all the, you know, embroidery and all the accoutrement accessories and have you worship them, do meditation on them. Like there's some awesome dakini, you know, or yogini or something like that. This is what I'm talking about. This is bad news for you. I mean, this is worse than getting bird flu. I mean, it's spiritual bird flu, okay? And you can see it creeping in. I mean, I'm aware of, I'm very aware of this. It's, you know, you get burned enough, you start becoming aware of fire. And so one of the techniques would be to look at some of these graphics of these, you know, those yogini graphics of all these. Because look at history of India. I mean, some of the statues and some of the artwork and carvings. I mean, you see these women just dressed in just these, you know, amazingly, you know, clever outfits that, you know, it's just like, what in the world? That's coming back. I think that'll come back. I think that may be happening. They may put LED lights, you know, all sorts of miniature LED lights on themselves. I think wearable technology is coming, where we're going to have this yogini look, which is going to be very mesmerizing, actually. Very mesmerizing. Very seductive. And so you add all that together. You know, Jesus said it's so bad even saints are in danger of being seduced. This is what the end times are at. That's where we're at. But it's a dangerous, it's a dangerous one. You have to be very strong to do that. But that's a type of backburning too. If you look at these pictures of goddesses, the Hindu goddesses and all these goddesses in the East, of how they dressed and the you know, they can present themselves in a spiritually seductive way that is very, very powerful. And don't think that that isn't being studied, okay, by the fashionistas and the people who promote all this stuff. Don't think that that's not in the pipeline. Because they look at the artwork, spiritual artwork throughout history, and they notice all that stuff of how to make it look like, hey, I'm some, you know, awesome, you know, spiritual consort, Dakini or something. So they will dress as if they were some great spiritual consort. You want to see a real spiritual consort, take a look at that. Take a look at Chandra Sering Chodron, okay. That's a real Dakini. That's a real spiritual consort. How does she dress? Like a nun. I mean, extraordinarily dressed down. Okay. Very humble. No glamour at all. Her sister, by comparison, went the more glamorous route. She is the real thing. So that's an example. That's the real thing. The other stuff is fake. You know, she went into real depth. The yogini yoga culture. Yoga girl culture that's coming, again, is superficial, designed to fixate you on the superficial. That so you think you're being very spiritual, you think you're having this relationship with a spiritual consort, you think you're in, and you're not. You're just trying to make all absurdity good, which is a false interpretation of the real teachings. Very false. Very false. Very superficial interpretation, which in the West and in East too, is very prevalent. We think that, oh, the Neo-Advaita is just a new thing, you know, the superficial interpretation of all this stuff. No, it's been going on forever. You look at history, spiritual history, no, it's the same thing. Yeah, they say, oh, what is Dzogchen? Oh, it's, you know, hey, you know, the dog is barking. The moon came up tonight. That's, you know, that's Dzogchen. No, it's not. It has nothing to do with it. That's very, that, but that's, you know, that's the sort of, you know, what we call, you know, superficial Advaita, or whatever you want to call it. Not that all Neo-Advaitins are superficial. I wouldn't say that. Some of them may very well have realized truth, okay? But the overall yoga girl culture, that is that. You know, we think, okay, we're just, you know, everything's good. I mean, do whatever you want to do. It's all good in that way. The flesh is great. You know, no, that's not what is being said at all. But you can only realize that if you really, really go in depth. Otherwise, that you're going to run into that absurdist conclusion. So, but getting to what it's really about is very challenging. And the continuity fear will kick up. And you have to have the gut, you have to have the will for that challenge. Otherwise, you're going to be easily seduced. No question about it. Because the LED technology, it, you know, also remember the mood rings. That was the 70s. Mood rings is these rings change color depending on your mood. Don't be surprised if there's going to be this wearable dresses, clothing that will be able to sense body temperature and have something, you wear a band around your head which will sense your brain waves or something, and this will then get sent to LED, tiny little LED structures throughout the clothing that will put patterns of light and stuff that change according to how you feel and stuff. You know, and so when you're in like a meditative state, it'll be a certain color, and it'll be like that. And they'll be able to, those will become adept at controlling this, and they'll make themselves look like they're like goddesses, because they're like, there's all this violet light, the clothing's like violet light, that means their mind is in non-dualness or something. That's all totally bogus, okay? But this is coming. You know, biofeedback was a big thing back in the 70s, I think. Huge, huge. We went to biofeedback training and stuff. I think I might have... Did I ever do that? I might have done it maybe once or something. I took the edge off of it. You know, I was backburning. I've always been backburning the culture. So I can keep on doing the real work and don't get seduced by it. It's been very difficult though. But this is coming. This is coming. Wearable technology that's hooked in to your moods and emotions and intellect and everything, that people will be spending time meditating to show their status, spiritual status, by the clothing, how their clothing appears to others, like it's their aura, you know, like a wearable aura. They can, this is not it, because the real light is just clear light. It's the clear light. You can't perceive that sense. You can't see with your senses. You know, no, it's superficial, that stuff that's going on in the world, but it can appear to be very, very intriguing. And don't underestimate those who do that, the models and stuff, who push that, they're very, very clever at what they do. They're very skillful. They know their business. Don't underestimate the cleverness, you know, of Adam and Eve's story. Don't underestimate the cleverness of Eve. You know, Adam's toast. Eve's going to say, "Eat this apple," and Adam's, you know, going to eat it. That's the yoga girl thing. Eve was the primordial yoga girl. Okay, superficiality. Eat the apple of superficiality. And we're certainly eating the apple, pun intended, of superficiality now. Big time. Apple computer, I'm sure they'll come out with something. The next big thing may be some sort of wearable technology in this way. The watch, literally, it wasn't such a big thing, but they're probably working on something right now. You can bet on it. Very reptilian, right? Very chameleon-like, of showing your changing colors. It's like, oh, you can, you know, you're aware of what I'm feeling. And of course, they could fake it. Of course, they become adept at adopting whatever emotion. Like an actress, she'll just get into her, okay, this is emotion I'm feeling. They see someone that they want to target, they'll fake a spiritual feeling or something. Like, oh, look how you make me feel so spiritual. Wow, you must be very advanced. I don't feel this way for very many people, you know. And then they'll hook you like that as some, you know, oh, I'm meant for you. I'm your soulmate. I'm your spiritual consort, soulmate. It's been going on since Eve. This apocryphal story, for sure. But this is more than just, you know, it's It's a whole seduction into superficiality that affects men and women. Absolutely. You think a woman like Chandra, sering children, you think she wanted to get hooked into superficiality? No way. She had to fight against it. It was very difficult. She spent her whole life with tremendous discipline. Receiving tremendous number in the court of the king. She spent it in her time as a courtier in the court of the king. Of Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro, the king. Yeah, Dharma king. Who's a Dharma king? She spent her time in the court of the Dharma king. And that was tough. It was difficult. We need to be courtiers in the court of spiritual aristocracy, spiritual royalty. Spiritual royalty. This is our calling. This is how you do it. I've spent my whole life in the court of spiritual royalty as a courtier. Absolutely, I have. So I'm you would say I'm a very, very practiced courtier. Very much so. And the only way to do it is to do it. And you gotta be careful that some yoga girl scheme doesn't come along and say, hey, you know, you can be a king too. You know, if you just, I'll worship you as a king. And look, I'm made for you. You know, I'll set you up as a figurehead. It's very interesting, the world right now. I was talking to a lot of people today because people are raw. People are willing to open up now because they realize we're in big trouble here. Hey, duh. Yeah, right? Let's talk about stating the obvious. And there's no better position than being an elder Caucasian American man. That's the very best position to be in now because we're the ones being blamed for everything. And the adversity is extreme. So you realize, hey, I have to do something about this. So it's a great position to be in. Most are not getting with it. They realize that, you know, there's something. I'm just not sure, you know, what a sunset. Wow, beautiful. They're not getting with it. But they're talking about it. Absolutely, they're talking about it. And the truth of the matter is the future, the New World Order religion is completely controlled by feminists, completely controlled by women feminists, feminist women. Yoga girl, the yoga girl culture, but it's they already control it. They already control it lock, stock, and barrel. And men have no authority in this New World Order at all, religion at all. Because what the feminists said from the very get-go, they said women have a special capacity to see things, have a certain perspective that men simply cannot have. They don't possess that. It's impossible for them to see it that way. And this perspective is a better spiritual perspective. Therefore, only women can truly have authority in this new perspective. Men are incapable of it. This was from the very beginning. This was what they said. They were very open about, because they were talking about it amongst each other. They said, how are we going to do this? And they said, let's just claim this. Well, this is the Eve thing. And this has been claimed throughout history. When they want to assert themselves in a certain way, they feel that it's safe to do so. And so it's impossible for a man to have any authority in the New World Order religion. It's impossible. All they can be used is figureheads. And servants, figureheads, functionaries, bureaucratic functionaries, figureheads, but no authority. No authority to speak truth whatsoever, because by definition, men can't speak truth because they don't have this advanced perspective that only women can have. It's something that God gave women in order to really fix things the right way. And men are, by gender, incapable of having this perspective. Now, this is the very definition of sexism. There's nothing more sexist than feminists. They're the most sexist people, mindset it's ever been in this world. That's how bad they are. Because they're literally claiming that men are incapable of genuine spiritual recognition and authority in speaking truth. Incapable by the fact that they're men. This is the New World religion. So I'm not going to have any part of that. I mean, speaking truth is what I'm all about. I speak from the authority of my own truth within me that I'm seeing, which is the one truth, okay, which is the one truth that is. And I speak the truth that I get from the Dharma kings and the great saviors, because I'm a courtier in their court of spiritual royalty. So I speak from that standpoint. And so I speak a truth, okay, with authority. And in the yoga girl religion, New World Order religion, men cannot do that. They will not be allowed to do that. No way possible. So there's no place for me in the New World Order, New World religion. No place for me whatsoever. I know this. Of course I'm looking for something else, right? Just flunkies, figurehead flunkies is the only place. You'd have to be just an idiot. Yeah, really. So, someday soon I'll be a Dharma prince. Really, seriously. Not a king, a prince. And a prince serves the Dharma kings, okay? I mean, Dharma is just a way of saying spiritual teaching. The ones who really know. The prince is the one who helps serve and help the empowerment of the Dharma king, giving the empowerment out to those, the courtiers, and those who are aligned with the overall transmission of truth. That's what a Dharma prince does. Helps out. But they certainly speak with a tremendous amount of authority. And we can practice. I can be a Dharma prince. I will be a Dharma prince. I am already a Dharma prince. I'm already a Dharma prince. So you spend a lifetime of intense abidance in the court of spiritual royalty. And this is training to be a Dharma prince. Absolutely it is. And you have to do things their way. And you have to learn the spiritual etiquette. And you have to become very, very spiritually fluent. Okay? You have to be very fluent. And so you understand what's being said, what's being transmitted, what the purpose is, what the goal is, what the skillful means are, all of this stuff. And the necessity for what's the determination. You have to be up on all of that. The whole thing. You have to be familiar with it, not intellectually, oh, I went to a retreat and I got it. No, you have to really, it has to be in your bones. It has to be completely, saturated. You have to be saturated with it. You have to spend time, a lifetime in my case, in the court of the Dharma kings and queens, in royalty, right? Not in my mind, you're Dharma queen for sure. Almost 20 years in that court. It's not so much as fun. I mean, some of it was fun, but it's because, I mean, her perspective is, she says you have to get over the idea that you eventually reach a point where there's no definite approach to anything. There's just so many, many different approaches. There's no definite answer for anything. Yeah. So it makes it pretty difficult. That's a very tough one. Maybe even, it's just... but it certainly is like, it challenges you. It's very challenging. It can be very, maybe almost too vague. It's just because she get a different approach for every single person is really what she did. And, that has its place. I mean, her style has its place. It's not the only style of royalty there is. I prefer Jesus' style. I prefer Longchenpa's style. I prefer Ram Maharshi's style, actually. But her style is very legitimate and very much great, to say the least. It might be too great, it's just so transcendent of any answers whatsoever, really. She just saw everything as unique as far as what to do, which is ultimately true. But it's not the only style. It's not the only way to look at it, actually. Ramana was more, he said, look, do the inquiry. Who am I? Who is it that's on the path? Find out who's on the path. Forget about the path. Who's on the path is a way of looking at it. I prefer looking at it like this. Who is it that's on the path, the spiritual path? Find out that. Just look at that. And he said, when you look at it, it'll disappear. It's not there anymore. It's very valid. Very valid. Longchenpa points out, this is very much an intrinsic spaciousness. And this tremendous non-dual perspective is just wonderful. His advice is just scintillatingly wonderful. And then Jesus' context is just the best. It really is. It's unsurpassed. Let's put it that way. It's unsurpassed context. Why are we in this pickle fix anyway? Jesus answers that very clearly. You know, so Jesus has his style. So the royalty has different styles. This is true. Very true. But I'm comfortable with all of them, actually. I'm very comfortable with all of them. And some days I prefer one, you know, and some days I prefer another. So it's like that. The Sufis, for instance, send their aspirants to like different masters, and you spend a couple of years with one, a couple of years with another, and then you move around, so you get used to these different styles. It's helpful. Because that helps you avoid superficiality, really. So down to my mom, they might dress her up like Krishna with a flute and everything. And at first it's so intriguing, wow. And now it's like, come on, really? Okay, you're Krishna with a flute and got a lot of flowers, so what? I don't care. There's no, what's the point of that? flowers everywhere. You never see flowers on Ramana Maharshi. Have you ever seen him wearing flower lace? I don't think I've ever seen him with flowers, ever. Interesting, right? Different style. Very different style. Jesus either. You don't, but not in my mom. Always flowers. The flower girl, you know. But look at that. Remember, when we do stuff like that, it's back-burning exercise. It's not designed to hook you into it. It's designed to unhook you from it. So I use these teachers for back-burning. Now, if they don't like it, they could tell me, or let it be known. I find it very helpful, actually. So, people might say it's a little bit irreverent. It's not irreverent from coming from me. Okay, it's very specific, skillful means. It needs to be understood. You use like a mandala, like a Longchenpa. Thangka or a tapestry, mandala, beautiful. And then I use change it in Photoshop in terms of the colors and textures and sharp and make it look different. It looks different and it has an effect like wow. Okay, I can't be seduced by the mandala itself, but looking at the mandala can also be very helpful. So it's not precluding, you know, genuine help from it, but it's avoiding the superficiality of it. So the yoga girls cannot hook you on like, oh, I've got this mandala, come meditate with me. We'll meditate on a mandala of Longchenpa. You know, I've already, you know, done that. I've seen all the mandalas of Longchenpa and these great Tibetan Vajrayana Buddhists, etc. And I've, you know, meditated on them and I've even changed them around, made it look different and everything. I said, okay, you know, I've been there, done that and had the insights. And now it's really about full stop on the wow, actually, for me, which is just sitting here quietly, not looking at anything. Not even looking at you. Yeah, right? So I've been through all this stuff and I've avoided a lot of it. You know, the gazing at one another and looking to my eyes and gazing and all this. Oh my God, it's so much junk. So much junk we've been through. And what happened? We have a culture that's imbecilic, spiritually imbecilic right now. That's the upshot of it all. It's the upshot. They're imbecilic. Now, you know, nobody likes to hear too much about politics and stuff. I boycott all that stuff. But on one level, you got to face the facts. We're going to have a choice between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump in the United States. And by repercussions, this is, you know, around the world, has heavy repercussions for the future of this planet. That's a choice, unless Hillary's in prison or Trump's, you know, buried 6 feet under the ground. Both of those are possibilities. It might both happen. You know, then what? Then what? Right? So we're facing like just a real, it doesn't matter who wins. It's going to cause just a great disturbance either way. All right? This is just a fact. Without even having to take sides. We don't have to take sides, I mean. To look at it this way, it's going to cause a massive disturbance, and the disturbance is already coming. And there's many other disturbances in the world. People are going to be looking for shelter, and that's when the yoga girls are going to pounce. The yoga girls are like these cougars. You know, the cougars like an older woman who seeks for younger men. That's what the yoga girls are like. They're like cougars, and they're going to pounce on these naive people in the world, especially men, like babies. They're like babies. They're going to just maul them, absolutely maul them, spiritually maul them. Just use them up. It's terrible. It's terrible what's coming. They try to jump on me. They're going to get some Dakini, wrathful deity, coming down on them, you know? In high esoteric Vajrayana Buddhism, they have these wrathful deities, Mahayana too, I think. Those are Dharma protectors, okay? And those Dharma protectors are there for a reason. And Samaya is there for a reason. It's because this has been going on. This isn't a new thing. This has been going on throughout history, okay? Absurdity always has its schemes. Always. The cougar is going to spring, and some gigantic lion is going to, they're going to be there, you know? Yeah, Longchenpa is a giant lion. They think when he before he's born, his mother had this dream of like a huge lion with a sun for a head, like a solar sun for a head, just shining everywhere. You're gonna try to take a bite out of the sun. Be blinded by the light. So I saw in a dream these cougars sprang upon this child. A baby. It was just a young kid. And I went running over there, and I drove that cougar off. I said, "You leave them alone." But you know, it's that naive kid brought it upon themselves for being lackadaisical. The whole world is spiritually lackadaisical now. You cannot succeed by being lackadaisical. You cannot. Continuity fear will just bury you. And superficiality. You'll be attracted to superficiality and then just get buried in it like a sinkhole. You go down the sinkhole of superficiality. For sure you will. So you cannot be intimidated by cougars. You cannot be intimidated by them. They're very intimidating. There was one in a store yesterday, a yoga girl. Good Lord. It's like, wow. I got really rocked by it, you know, a bit rocked by it. So, this one was, man. Talk about a cougar mentality. This person was sharp and strong, and you know, strike like lightning kind of thing, and just yoga grilled out to the max. And you know, it's just like. Shock troop, you know, SS shock troop should have been. You know, that's so, I was like, wow. Getting her yoga girl food on, too. All these power bars. And she just like said, you know, I am ready to pounce. Zaya's in there getting my beats. I'm in there, you know, I went in there at home and I blended those beats. Yeah, you know what? You can't make nice with when the cougar pounces. You know, this is serious business. You got to drive him off. And they're there to traumatize you into the superficial by saying that the real path is too traumatic for you. So here's an excuse. All right, here's an excuse to be, will traumatize you, but that's a good excuse. Now you got a great excuse. And if you're lackadaisical on the path, this is what you're going to fall for sure. For sure. The Nine of My Miles was the, great advocate of the brisk path, okay? And it's just basically like a parrot repeating it over and over. Your progress has to be brisk. You must be enthusiastic. You must have this attitude of I can't, I can't wait to get to the spiritual gym and work out. You must be cheerful about it. You must, the enthusiasm. You must get into it. You must more, brisk. Every day, brisk this. This is your work. She says, otherwise, you're going to get dragged down for sure. Yeah. It's absolutely true. Longchenpa is a great Dharma protector. Great Dharma. I call hell help. The spiritual culture is in danger of being wiped out. Who showed up? Longchenpa showed up. Like a general. He says, don't worry. General's here. General Longchenpa is on the scene. And I need some good lieutenants. Yeah, like lieutenant or something, An officer for sure. All right. I'm not just some grunt. I'm an officer. He needs officers. Absolutely. Dharma protectors need those officers. That's another way of putting it. My family is military. We're officers. Okay. Come from that culture. Teachers, officers, stuff like that. So that feels natural to me. I'm not, I respect the grunts, absolutely. You kidding? I can get in there in the trenches with them. Absolutely. Lieutenants generally do. They are in the trenches, they're there. They're in on the battlefield. It depends. There's a whole chain of majors and major generals and this kind of stuff. There's a chain of command, and some are on the battlefield. This is going to get real nasty because they're going to do all this nanotechnology where they say they can infect you with something that'll make you really ugly, come out with all boils all over your face and everything. But they have the antidote for it. And if you, do what they tell you to do, then they'll give you the antidote. So you cannot be freaked out from ugliness. Website, Glenn Losack, MD, I think, on Flickr. He's a great photographer. He really is. He's one of the greatest I've ever seen, if not the best. He's won many awards. He's acknowledged as one of the best photographers in the world. He's on Flickr. He is. I'm very impressed. I could tell. I didn't even know that. I just thought I was visiting some amateur Flickr site. I just saw some pictures. I said, whoever took these pictures is a genius photographer. Wow. And then I went to about him and it shows just all the awards he's won. And he is a top-notch photographer in the world. And what he takes is real life of suffering and misery and abnormality and sickness and stuff. He's a doctor, psychiatrist, and MD. I think it's Glenn Losack, LOSACK or something like that. Dr. GLEN, I think one N. I'll put a link on this video. You've got to be very careful though. This is backburning because the pictures are very graphic. and shocking of people suffering from terrible physical abnormalities. And I was just able to laugh at it all. Not in a rude, nasty way, but in a, this too, sacrificial offering, it's all okay. You don't fool me one bit. You're still perfect. You know, when the laughter is, you think you can fool me by appearing to be all grotesque? You don't fool me at all. You're perfect. It's that kind of thing, that sort of laughter. And none of my mom would laugh that way. Sometimes they'd tell her some terrible thing and she'd burst out in laughter. She'd laugh in most inappropriate situations and people got very upset about it. But she wouldn't apologize. She said, you can't fool me. I see you. You're God. What are you trying to, you're hiding from me, huh? God, trying to hide from me, God? No, you can't hide. God can't hide from God. Sorry. Because we're God being God. Come on. And, you know, so one way of explaining it. So that's a back-burning exercise. So we have skillful means here. Let's make no mistake about it. This is a place of skillful means. And you know, people might be looking for, well, I've got to study Vajrayana Buddhism, you know, and Atti Yoga or Anattara Yoga or something like that. And to get real as, you know, find some thousand-year-old text and something. No. Skillful means are right here, right now. Backburning is a very skillful means. Very profound, very high. I got Longchenpa on my side, you know? Okay, you talk about someone who is the all-time genius of skillful means, he's right there, up in the top echelon, for sure. For sure. There isn't anything you could just look at and you could just tell. Nanda Maima is also absolute top echelon of all that. She knows all paths. Okay, skillful means. So we're not bound to some skillful means of somebody in Bihar or Bengal or something. No, we're not. We are not. We're not spiritual peasants. I got to tell you that. We're spiritual royalty. We're aligned with spiritual royalty here. We're not spiritual peasants here at all. And we're using what works right now, and we're getting help from the top teachers of all time in history right now. And so I've led to the site and it helped me out. It helped me out. Thank you very much, Dr. Glenn. Because the shock factor is very strong, but it didn't bother me at all. Be careful though, it's potent. But you can get the edge off, shock off, maybe, because I believe that the warfare in the future is image warfare. And they say, we'll mess up your image. We'll give you this disease. It won't kill you, but it'll horribly disfigure you. Or you'll have all these abnormal growths taking place on your body. In other words, designed to freak you out, freak your image out, your superficial image out, that they manipulate superficial. They manipulate image, okay? They're very good at it. And there are ways to cause that. They've been studying it. They know, in my opinion, they already know how to bring out these terrible disfiguring diseases and stuff. And again, they have antidotes for that. And so they'll hold you hostage and ransom. You know, you do what we say, and we'll give you the antidote. If you don't, you'll be walking around like some hideous, disfigured monster. So, is there a spiritual antidote for this stuff? It's a good question, isn't it? Looking into it. Jesus healed all sorts of physical disfigurations, did he not? Did he not? He absolutely did. That was a terror that was held over people to be infected and become lepers or something, right? He cast that yoke of terror off. He said, look, all absurdity is equally absurd. I'm not caught in the net of consideration at all. This is what Longchenpa's getting at. The great, he expresses it. Longchenpa is a genius for expression. Genius for the gems of appropriate words and expression. And it hits hard, and you understand what he's getting at. Really, you can see it. He helps you see what he's getting at. It's extraordinary grace. So they're not caught in this net. So it's nothing to them. You're perfect. You're perfection. You're already whole. So the path, the royal path, is to take. The goal is already present. Perfectly present. It's already perfectly present. There's nothing you need to do to make it present at all. And then get used to this fact. That's the high path. Leads you to liberation from the belief in liberation in one lifetime. There's nothing to be liberated from at all. There's no need to seek for liberation. We are it. We don't become liberated. We are liberation, meaning we are freedom. We are freedom. And something very helpful I'll share with you, it happened yesterday. I realized that Jesus has this quote that I saw one of the videos of Martin Maharshi. I add some quotes from other royalty Jesus on my Mon Longchenpa in Ron Maharshi's slideshow to show the collegiality of it. We're all on the same team. And he says that God, in no way throughout all of God's creation does God ever have a special thought or consideration or perspective on anything whatsoever. None. No specialness ever whatsoever. None. And I thought, oh, how horrible. I can never earn God's grace or get merit from God. And suddenly my mind said, wait a minute. I see it in a different light. That's freedom. Meaning nothing can bind me at all. I'm totally free. And I just like, wow. Talk about being rocked by a wow. I said, oh my God, this is perfect. This is wonderful. Oh, this is freedom. The lack of specialness is our freedom. And I saw it. I saw it very clearly. So this is something a Dharma prince would see. Absolutely. Absolutely. This is a perspective. So the perspective of a Dharma prince is coming upon me. It absolutely is. That was a big one. Oh, wonderful. How wonderful. Nothing can bind me. Nothing can bind you, which means we are absolutely free to experience anything we want to experience. We're not trapped at all. It's specialness that the belief in specialness is what traps us. Absolutely it does. Then we think we have to earn merit from God, which is impossible. But then we think we have to change God, so God is a God of merit. And then we think we have to ransom ourselves from this God, you know, and because we can't get rid of the paranoia, we have to purchase freedom from paranoia, that God is a business person or something, right? We get trapped in this whole belief, false belief system. We build religions and belief system. We try to sanctify it, right? And get more and more enmeshed in it. And then we fall into absurdity of, well, just everything's absurd. It's all absurd. Let's just be happy with absurdity, you know. If you can't beat them, join them. And then the sinkhole opens up and you fall into this so-called sinkhole. At least you think you do. But from the standpoint of momentum, you fall in a sinkhole of lack of momentum, of lackadaisicalness, and you make a religion out of being lackadaisical. And then you then prettify it, you know, put flowers around it. I can't find that video of all the flowers, things that I did, arrangements and stuff. I can't find that videos. I was looking for it. I wasn't meant to find it. But I went through a massive amount of flower arrangements and setting up a whole entire like spiritual scene, mise en scene, where gatherings. I put on these virtual gatherings, spiritual gatherings. Nobody attended them, but I had it all set up as if many people would attend, like huge amounts of high yogis and yoginis would be attending this, and apostle. I mean, really, you know, like this big spiritual gathering. I set the whole thing up, all prepared for it, with these gorgeous flower arrangements everywhere, and tapestries, and incense, and all this stuff. Nobody ever attended. Nobody never attended. I was just out there by myself. I said, what am I doing? But you know, I had all the flower lays there for everybody. I had hundreds of flower lays that would be put flower beautiful seashells. Everybody gets this gorgeous seashells and bangles and wrist things and lays and just dressed up like you're like super spiritual. The altar, there's altars just dripping with flowers and beautiful pictures and incense and bells and all these bells, you know, Vajra, you know, spiritual accessories. I had everything. And I'd put on these I would build up the set. I had actual spiritual sets. I'd build everything and get it prepared for this massive spiritual celebration. I called it celebration. I composed music for it. I had all the instruments for the musicians, the whole band, and playing. So I did all this stuff. It was called, you know, virtual gathering is what I did. Nobody ever came to it. I had the graphics, the signs, the posters, massive posters of Ananda Mahima draped in flowers, for instance. So I've already done all that stuff. Nobody ever attended it. But for me, it's like, are you kidding? I'm not interested in that now. You know, it's like, whatever, okay. Moving on from that. And all the food, you know, the massive food, the plates. I still have all the stuff, a lot of the stuff. I got rid of a lot of it, but all sorts of beautiful plates, spiritual plates, and place settings. The place settings just make it look so spiritual, like you're in paradise. I had all that stuff, and I spent all my time setting up these sets, like as if, you know, that the goddess was here. God was here, the goddess was here, these like great gurus were here, and there's huge gatherings coming to these great gurus, and we're all totally decked out in just, you know, utterly great, you know, yoga fashion, and had all the ornamentation and clothing and fashion, everything. I actually had clothes for everybody, tell you the truth. I had many, many sets of clothes. I had like 30 bags of clothing for the people coming, of dressing up in these extraordinary costumes. Just putting on the Ritz to the ultimate extent. Enough for a lot of people. I had a whole wardrobe, massive areas of wardrobe, whole wardrobe area. I spent all my time going to antique shops, buying all this clothing, buying all this stuff. Every day, I'd scour all the antique shops and buy all this stuff. Jewelry, massive amounts of beautiful jewelry to wear, ornamentation, everything. Hats, hundreds and hundreds of hats, all different types of hats. So you could just dress up in myriads of different ways to make you feel so spiritual and tune into this. And nobody ever came. Nobody ever came. Nobody ever wore any of the stuff except for me. I've been through thousands and thousands and thousands of outfits. I could go through like hundreds a day. I would go through these dressing changes of clothing, hundreds a day. Just all these variations. Try this, now try this, now try this, now try this. Handbags. Just massive amounts of everything. Shoes, you name it. Shirts, you name it. Dresses, you name it. Yeah, everything, for men and women. So I had these antique clothing for men and women that are just like so awesome, you know, like from the early 1900s, old style, you know, beautiful, beautiful embroidery stuff, old style. It's just like you're going to like the most greatest church gathering ever happened. I had all that stuff, massive amounts of it. So I wore all that stuff. I said, how would it be to look like this? How would it be to look like this? Okay, how spiritual does this make me feel? Of course, none of it works at all. You put the whole combination together of all the flowers, all the rituals, everything. No, doesn't work. Longchamp, I even points this out. It's your intention. It's your intention that works. You can engage in that other stuff, he says, endlessly. Get you nowhere. I mean, hibiscus, I actually grew flowers. I spent a lot, massive effort having a ton of flowers. I had so many marigolds. I actually had a whole supply of beautiful marigolds. So everybody could have, you know, marigolds everywhere, covering, you know, beautiful water feature fountains. You name it. I can find that. I got the video somewhere of all this stuff. I just, you know, was just dressed up to feel like you've just entered like the sanctuary, a spiritual sanctuary. Superficial, right? But wow, I'm telling you, those yoginis, those yoga girls, they, you know, when you set up a set like that, and they're all decked out to the max, and what, you know, what, to seduce you, You know, you're gonna get seduced by that stuff. Most people will. You come in, the incense. I mean, we're going to Easter service soon, coming up, right? They put on the Ritz for that. The Catholic Church does, but that's nothing compared to what the yoga girl culture can do. Really, well, the church is pretty good. I mean, they have, I mean, the cathedrals, because just the building itself, right? It's pretty amazing. They really want to make it very awesome, so you could fixate on the superficial there if you wanted to, for sure, and get lackadaisical about it all. But these au naturel outside kind of celebrations can be also very, very, very heady stuff. As the pagans know, the pagans are very good at that sort of stuff. Pagan culture is what we're talking about, really. But, you know, I mean, there's really, what's the difference between that and a massive cathedral? It's still pagan culture, really. None of my mom would say, we got already too many temples, too many spiritual buildings. I don't want you to build any more. It's just that's not where it's at. It's your practice that's where it's at. Oh, but we want to, you know, put your statue in there. We want to do this. No, I'm not interested in that. That's not going to free you. It's not going to free anybody. So all this backbirding is helpful. Part of being in the court of spiritual royalty is you have to stop being attracted by, you know, the peasants, spiritual peasantry, and the pageantry of spiritual peasantry. You can't be a spiritual peasant and hang out in the court of the Dharma kings and queens, because that's not where it's at. You have to do real practice there. You have to really, really glimpse truth and go through the shock of that and glimpse success. Glimpse success, I'd realize I have to accept on the fact that I'm a Dharma king too. I got no way around it. We're all Dharma kings and queens. Absolutely we are. 100%. 100%. We're perfect. We're absolutely divine. And one has to see this. That is the path of asserting this. Asserting that we're absolutely divine right now. Perfectly free spirit, formless spirit. This is the path of continually bringing that to our attention and asserting it and saying that, you know, that there's no way around it. There is no way around it. And this has to be very clear. And when you hang out in the court of the Dharma kings and queens, it's very clear, because they are it, you know? They are it. And they realize there's no way around it. And they tell you, you are it too. You know, got news for you, you're it too. We're all it. We are all it. And there's no way around it. This is the great teachers tell you, there's no way around it. Whereas the spiritual peasants, they actually think they're superior. Because they say, no, we know way around, we have a way around it. And this peasantry we're in, actually, this is just our spiritual practice so we can get to the point where we're greater than God. We're greater than God. So really, you know, the truth of this world is the spiritual peasants, they think they're superior. They absolutely do. That is a fact here. And so they think that you're just actually inferior. They're better, way better. That's their attitude. It really is. So I say, I'm in the court of the Dharma kings and queens. And they say, we're way better than that. You know, that's old style. It's old fashioned. It's archaic. You know, we're way past that. Literally, it's the arrogance of trying to be better than God. But guess what? There's no way around the paranoia of that. There's no way around it. And there's no way around the impossibility of it whatsoever. But yet they think there is. So they think they're smarter. So they say, I don't have to hang out in the course of the Dharma kings and queens. Go, I got a better path than that. We're going to be better than that. And so they think they're, you know, they're wandering in this hell. They think, well, that's the price I got to pay for it. But we're really superior. So they all the time they think they're superior. They really do. Scratch a spiritual peasant and you get a superiority complex, guaranteed. Guaranteed. Now, is the world messed up beyond? Is it foobar? Is it freaked out? I'll use that term, freaked out beyond repair, or is it, some great progress is being, this is the question, isn't it? The Holy Spirit seems to indicate it's freaked out beyond repair right now, and God's gonna have to sort it out. Holy Spirit's gonna have to sort it out, and this happens. This happens. Lackadaisicalness cannot have spiritual religion with if you're lackadaisical about it, and it cannot be superficial. It has to be genuine. You have to genuinely engage with it. If not, the sinkhole happens. Sinkholes happen. Okay, so we know this, and apparently the sinkhole is going to happen here. Jesus said it would. It is happening now. That's the different opinions. This is it's a tough question. I've been asking this today. Holy Spirit indicated to me, it's sinkhole's going to happen here. I mean, it's foobar. freaked up beyond all repair. Our whole all recognition. I mean, it's beyond repair. It's beyond repair. You got to flee from it. The other side is to say, no. There's this great spiritual awakening taking place, and the education will bring about a new world order, a new world age of enlightened humanity. That's yoga girl culture. And there are those who advocate that. Drakul, the supposed Tibetan adept, head of a monastery in Tibet, supposed, well, there are, thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands. I mean, a monastery, how many Dzogchen monasteries in Kham alone, were there a couple thousand or something, which the Chinese cultural revolution communists destroyed almost all of them. They destroyed most monasteries in Tibet, along with the statues and relics and everything. I mean, the Padmasambhava looks like me statue, they destroyed it. It's extraordinary iconoclastic, just unbelievable lack of respect. It's just, I can't even fathom that, really. Just insane arrogance on their part. And that's a big trend in the world, right? Anyway. Drakul is a head of some certain important monastery. Well, there's a lot of important monasteries. Every tradition has a number of them, 4, 5, 6, 7, whatever. Nyingma, the Sakya, Kagyu, and Gelugpa. They all have these very important monasteries, and there's a lot of offshoots of all that. A lot of division, a lot of different lineages, and they have their important monasteries too. There's just a massive number of monasteries in Bhutan, Nepal, Tibet, Greater Tibet, all over. Just so many, 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 many. Okay, somebody is the head of a monastery. Okay, well, it's very learned. The Tibetan Buddhists tend to be extremely learned. Drakul is obviously extraordinarily learned. Yes, and he says he's part of this spiritual hierarchy that has the development of this planet as part of their agenda, and they overlook the spiritual development of this planet, and it's designed to bring this planet into become a spiritual planet. Okay, and his writings about it are extraordinarily sophisticated. Spiritually sophisticated. He's got this all these schematics, like he just, they work, seem to have this vast treasure trove of schematics of how to do this. And he's super optimistic that, there's troubles working through the glamours. We got to burn this stuff up, but we will get there. And so that's, this has become theosophy through first Madame Blavatsky, then Annie Besant, and then Alice Bailey. I don't know. Were those yoga girls, right? Bringing in yoga culture that we have now, which eventuated in the United Nations. Actually, the United Nations was a theosophical idea, as was the League of Nations. And the United Nations really has theosophy as part of, is the new world religion. Absolutely, it does. And this is, their belief is that they can educate the world to, this would be a wonderful spiritual plan, and we're all going to spiritualize the planet. Now, a nod in my mind would say, what are you talking about? Everything is already perfect, absolutely spotlessly perfect. As would Ramana Maharshi, Longchamp, Jesus, they have a different perspective. So it's very perplexing. The theosophy says that Jesus is the head of the whole hierarchy right now, I believe, or Sanat Kumara actually is, or this, he's the solar logos or deity. And Jesus is now occupying the planetary head of this planetary hierarchy. He's in charge. Buddha used to be in charge. Now Jesus is in charge. So he's overseeing the schematics and the plan of how to build this new world order of a spiritual planet. Buddhists think Maitreya is, the Islam thinks this, the Mahdi is, or you know, the Hindu thinks that the Kalki avatar is. So they all have this idea that there's going to be this great head of some spiritual hierarchy come here and iron everything out. Well, and Joaquin is so learned, I don't want to disrespect Tibetan Buddhists at all, because you know, they're just extraordinary. So it's a question, isn't it? But ultimately, the Holy Spirit's the one that knows the answer. And the answer the Holy Spirit has given me is you have to flee. You got to flee. It's going to become just insanely confusing here. The superficiality and absurdity is just going to spin off in every possible direction, really. And how do you schematicize for absurdity? It's you know, those who think they have all these schemes for it. Dracul himself says, like, well, we've been fooled many times, that we thought we had it nailed down and something different happened. And then he says, well, God, you know, God's mind is unfathomable. Well, I would have to question that and say, maybe they're dealing with absurdity. It's absurdity that's unfathomable. And you don't know what it's going to do, really. Because it's whimsical, it's absurd. And absurdity always has an out. You know, you can't pin it down. You cannot. So you keep trying to schematicize for absurdity. You're going to keep being fooled over and over and over and over. And of course, they're involved with extraterrestrials. They say, well, they're helping out. I mean, this is part of this cosmic scheme to help planet Earth and the whole solar system here and the galaxy and everything. And no doubt that all that stuff exists as far as in some mind forms and stuff. Yeah, sure. And so that's all going on, but is it legit? Is it really legit? Because they keep getting fooled. They say we thought we all had it all worked out, and it didn't go the way we thought. And they say we need to go back to the drawing board, and because God, obviously, they say God has this unfathomable creativity, and he will change things, or things will come up that we didn't see. And they say, wow, you know, we need more knowledge about the cosmos. And they're very into planets and stars and astrology, and how everything is like cosmically affects everything else. And it's just like this unbelievably intricate dance, God's dance of everything affecting everything else. And so it's endlessly complex. The system of endless complexity. And so they get it wrong. They just say, oh, well, there's a depth of complexity that we haven't yet reached. We haven't mastered it yet. So they call themselves masters of different levels, you know, third degree, fourth degree, fifth degree master, then sixth degree, seventh degree. And there's this whole massive corporate hierarchy of mastering the complexity of the cosmos. I don't get any of that from our four root teachers at all. Not a word of it, really. Not really a word of it. So what is going on? It's really perplexing, isn't it? But the theosophy claims that all the alignments of the planets and everything is like super, super. These are esotericists. That there's esoteric Christianity, too, that believe in that. That everything has to be aligned a certain way. They think Jesus was talking about that, that everything happens at a certain time. I mean, the Judaism of Kabbalah is very into that, you know, of these cosmic doors and stargate. Everything happens and aligns in, you know, the center of the galaxy, and then, boom, we have this, you know, special change and transformation happening. happens and all these things. They're totally into that. Numerology, you name it. That God's will, it works out through this vast tapestry of complex juxtapositions. Well, if that's the case, where's the freedom? Where's the flatness of it all? I mean, there's no specialness. Jesus said God never has bestowed one iota of a specialness upon anything whatsoever. So how could you say there's a star has some special significance and we're controlled by it, where it's positioned? You know, it's very odd. Anyway. There's a massive amount of books written. You could call that Agni Yoga Bibles. Who did that? Rorik was part of that. But all these esoteric yogas tend to say that the masters understand the complexity, so they know what's going to happen and how to deal with everything ahead of time. Well, I mean, it could be just, you know, there's this dream plan to help us get free of our, you know, delusion of lack of freedom. Really, that's the only delusion there is, that we threw our freedom away, because we are freedom. So how could there be any delusion other than the delusion that we're not freedom? That's the only delusion there really can be, actually. But so this is a big question, really a big question, and it's never been answered to my satisfaction. But the Holy Spirit has intimated, you know, at least to me, say, hey, things going to be really messed up here. Really messed up. Now, will some order come out of that? You know, they love saying order out of chaos. You know, that's one of the cosmic rays, you know. Harmony through conflict. They divide everything up into seven different rays and seven different this and all these different esoteric, you know, levels of everything. Well, what we're getting at, there are no levels. Levels don't exist at all. This is the non-dual realization. There are no levels. Then how can you schematicize for freedom? You don't. You're already free. Everything's already free. There's only freedom. There's no blueprint for freedom at all. Actually, Ramaharshi says, leave it up to God. Leave it up to the Holy Spirit. It's very flexible, actually. You start getting too much into labels and symbols and all that stuff, it's like it's a very slippery slope. Very slippery slope. And the ETs are always complaining, well, yeah, we told you we're going to do this, but, you know, we didn't account for this. Something came in we didn't account for. It's like, wow, God threw a monkey wrench into it. What do you mean God threw a monkey wrench? How about absurdity threw a monkey wrench into it? How could absurdity see what it's really doing? If it did, it would be clear that it's absurd. So absurdity can't be clear that it's absurd and still be absurdity. It cannot be. So it's always going to get surprised. It has to be. You know, stuff surprises, hits you. Holy Spirit is the one that tells us surprises are coming. It's always told me this. It's been accurate so many times. When I listen accurately myself, spot on. Spot on. The Holy Spirit's spot on. But then again, you think, well, okay, I need to master the complexity of the white. No, I don't need to master any complexity. No. Go play golf. Golf helps you realize, don't try to master complexity. Don't try to figure out everything. Your golf game deteriorates when you do that. If you just play intuitively, you play better, actually. When you try to be real mechanical and robotic and figure everything out, you know, that's trouble. That's trouble. Even Tiger Woods would hit a shot that he felt was right. He went through all the song and dance of figuring everything out, but he just used his will and his intuition on what to do, ultimately. He said, this is what I'm going to make happen. I'm going to make this shot happen. You know, the golf course doesn't dictate. Golf course does not dictate to me what shot I hit. I dictate to the golf course what shot I'm going to hit. Really? That's how he played. So the caddies would give him the numbers, you know, analyze everything, but he'd say, okay, this is what I'm going to do. Okay? whether the golf course likes it or not. This is what I'm going to do. This is how the shot, this is what's going to happen. And I'm going to make it happen. So it was his will that was there. It wasn't some computer actually doing it. I just ordered a Tiger Woods shirt. It's got a little emblem on it. Little thing. Yeah, that's right. Out of respect. See, everybody's just, you want to know what was going to happen to you if you think you're going to be some figurehead of the New World Order. Look at Tiger Woods. The yoga girls took him down. Well, what happened? What happened? I just suddenly went black screen happened. Black screen, everything just went black. Holy cow. Was the screensaver maybe kicked in or something? Yeah. But yeah, they took him down. Everything went to black. But, you know, he was using some adeptness, really, his mind, in a very adept way, actually. He really was. I was aware of it. I was using psychokinesis, actually. He really did. He had tremendous mental capacities of concentration. Which is why he was so aloof. So, yeah, they took him down. Took him down real hard, real bad. Nike stayed with him. I'm not a fan of Nike. But let's call it as it is. Kudos to them. Almost everyone else abandoned him. Absolutely abandoned him. This is what will happen. He'll be abandoned. Nike did not abandon him. I guess they thought they'd sunk too much money in him. They had this massive contract that they didn't want to eat it. I went to a golf store recently. All these stuff's on sale, you know, clearance. Tiger Woods hats. You can have them, get them cheap now. Nobody's buying them. Nobody wants to wear a Tiger Woods hat because he's basically finished. This clearance blowout stuff. Blowout, yeah? Maybe I should get one. I might. I should have got one. I don't know. But I got a shirt I'll wear that. I wear shoes. Out of respect, because this is what, so I've said this before. I don't abandon somebody that's helped out just because the yoga girls take him down. Okay? Just because he's flawed or something, right? Yeah, we're all flawed. If the yoga girls target you, you're liable to be taken down. Anybody, almost anyone. They can't take Longchenpa down, okay? Good luck taking Longchenpa down. Good luck taking Jesus down. Good luck taking Ananda Mai Ma down. Good luck taking Ramana Maharshi down. You got to do all luck in the world is not going to help you, okay? But the rest of us, we can be taken down if they really target you, and they went really targeted him. Big time. He was causing problems because too many people were paying attention and getting the idea like, hey, I can be like Tiger Woods too. They didn't want that, actually. They didn't want that. Especially a lot of Afro-Americans, African-Americans, whatever you want to call it, people of darker complexion, they started getting ideas, you know what? I can be like Tiger Woods too. And they stopped feeling like they're slaves, you know, to the political machine, the bureaucracy, to the government, which is what New World Order wants them to be. And they took Tiger Woods down. He was becoming too big. He really was. He really, really was. He's getting too big. He was the number one global icon. And he's a good guy. He's a good guy. I met him. I hung out with him. Hung out around him, actually. On a number of occasions, I've been around Tiger Woods, and I think he's a good guy. But, you know, if they decide to take you down, you know, you're going to go down hard. So, you know, like I said, we got your back, Tiger. Don't think you've lost your position in the court, you know, and you haven't lost your position. Once you're a courtier, you don't lose your position. You don't lose your position. So, you know, get back on the bike. So that'll be interesting. The yoga girls, they hate it. You know, if you wear Tiger Woods, you're going to get in big trouble with the yoga girls, with most women in general, really. Because, you know, he's an example. They made an example of him. They absolutely did. Tried to chop him up in pieces. What brutal. What he's gone through is brutal. Doing the same thing to Trump. I mean, they're going to try to drag him through the streets like Mussolini, you know? I mean, if you let the rabble at him, they're going to go berserk. A bunch of berserkers around now. The country's going berserk, actually. They're going to try to make an example out of him, too. Scare everybody. You know, he's feisty enough to hang in there for a while. But, you know, I think he has some, you know, he's got some flaws. And, they'll use that to take him down. So, prepare for that. You've seen it. You get the heroes, then they destroy him. But they can't destroy Jesus, okay? They're trying their best. They're trying to take Jesus down now. Yoga culture is absolutely at it, hammer and tongs. You got some real sharpies there, you know, sharp pen. And they think that they're clever enough to do it. Like I said, good luck taking the real Jesus down. You know, they're taking down a straw man. That's all they're doing. If you think that any of these great teachers have been taken down one notch, one iota at all, you're looking at a straw man or a straw woman that they're attacking. That's it. They're not taking anyone down. But they just think they're so superior. They think they found a way around the impossible. Very arrogant. So I'm going to hang out, you know, work on my, you know, golf game, basically, a spiritual golf game. Someone showed me today something extraordinary. He had been there, and he just said, I got back from this place, and look at this, and he showed me on his phone. I was like, wow. It was the most awesome driving range you've ever seen in your life. It was just, like, I could hardly even fathom such a place. It's just amazing. They had 13 different separate greens, full green complexes, bunkered, pin, everything, beautiful green, all laid out at different distances, with different elevations, everything. Like you're shooting downhill, you're shooting uphill, side, everything. Like you're actually hitting approach shots into these greens. And it's all the way up to 280, 300 yards for drivers. I mean, it's just bunkers everywhere. It's just beautiful. I said, oh my God, if you have a practice range like that, you're going to get really good, like a pro, because you're going to be, because it's simulating hitting into genuine greens. So every shot you hit, you just start dialing it in. So if I have a green look like this, I know exactly what to hit into it and how to hit my shot into it. You're going to really become a pro. You're going to be playing like a pro when you practice on something like complex like that, really. So, and then what happened was a massive sinkhole opened up right in near the clubhouse and the course, a huge sinkhole. The practice range wasn't sucked into it, but almost. I mean, it was on the edge of it, but a lot of stuff got sucked into it. Part of the course, I mean, it was the clubhouse. It was insane. It's just opened up and a massive sinkhole. He showed me pictures of it. Oh my God. This is what's showing. Holy Spirit showing me a sinkhole. This world is like a spiritual sinkhole. Is going to open up, and you need to go to this practice range and get practice being a pro. What spiritual pro? You got to be a spiritual pro. You need going forward. There has to be to help out. You have to be a spiritual pro. You have to be a pro. You have to know how to hit your approach shots just right. You really do. I accept it. This is a fact. You want to be a Dharma prince. You got to be a pro. Absolutely, you do. You got to be able to go out on tour, like a pro. Pros tour. The game travels with them. Okay? Doesn't matter what the conditions are. You know, they know what shot to hit. And they can hit it. I'm always very impressed by golf pros. It's so difficult, the travel they go through, different conditions they play in. And, wow. I mean, they have the shots. It's just amazing to me. The mental discipline, it's almost unfathomable, really. But no, I say no, that there must be a way to do that. There has to be. But really, kudos to them. It is not easy. It's very much a mental discipline. Have to be very one-pointed. And really not be deterred at all. You're the boss. The golf course isn't the boss. And this is the key element to it all. You're the boss. So it takes a tremendous amount of belief in freedom, your freedom of expression and spirit, that your spirit and this golf course here is cannot dictate to you what the results are going to be. This is the focus they have to have. They have to have that. It's extraordinary. It's that way for anyone in this world. It's extraordinary. They're able to maintain a certain amount of focus to say, in this area, nothing's going to dictate to me what the results are. I used to be that way, but you know, got taken down by the yoga girl culture of spiritual superficiality. They targeted me for sure. Said, we can't have this. We can't have someone like this, like you here. You're freaking us out. Hey, you say, here, study this stuff instead. You know, study esotericism or whatever, but don't give me this stuff like, you know, you're perfect and nothing can bother you, that you dictate the results of the world. The world doesn't dictate anything to you. Don't give me that attitude. That's arrogant, you know. No, it isn't. It's arrogant to think that we can change reality, change perfection, change what we are. That's what's arrogant. That's totally arrogant. And what's racism? Racism says that your race has a special capacity that races don't. What is happening now is reverse racism in the world. Absolutely. What's sexism? Same thing. That our gender has a special capacity that you can never have. So now it's like the white race is inherently inferior. And some, you know, other races, whatever you want to say, they have some special capabilities. You call it like soul power for blacks. They have this special, you know, you don't have soul. So you can't really understand what spirituality is all about. Whites are incapable of it. This is the new world order. This is their viewpoint, that whites, you can't have real soul. Yeah, that's true. This is what they're saying. The other races are extremely racist, extraordinarily racist, actually. And yet, it's the whites who are claimed that they're the ones who are racist. And really, whites have been, there's been some racism, sure. But there's also been a lot of saying, hey, you can have the same capabilities that I have. You just have to work at it. You know, there's nothing inherently preventing you from it. But there is this vicious racism coming in the world, and vicious sexism, and vicious bigotry, okay, and vicious discrimination coming, all from these sacred cows, who are the ones who claim that you know, they're helping us get free of it. No, they're enmeshing us in it. They're the ones who are enmeshing us, saying this special group has this special quality that no one else has, and you can't have it, so they're the authorities, and you have to do what they say. They're the new authority figures. There's enslavement. It's enslavement. What's coming is New World Order is really enslavement. Very bad enslavement. Because the one that's saying you're not special, they're also saying that they are special. Okay? They haven't got the fact that there's no specialness whatsoever anywhere. Not even in Jesus. Not even in God. Nowhere. God gives all to all. There is no preference for anything, even to a specific to arise or not to arise at all. God doesn't say you must, this universe must arise, nor does he say it must not arise. Keep in mind that the history of this planet has mostly been matriarchal, and the matriarchs said that the women have some special power that men don't have, basically giving birth, and men can never understand what true authority really is. And men had to develop a counter-response to that spiritual enlightenment to get free of this tyranny that they were under, actually. If you look back throughout history and really study real ancient history and the religions of that time, what is the book, The Golden Bough or something? They're books that bring it to light, and it was just unbelievably sexist that women were super dominant, and men were like cattle, and they had no spiritual authority whatsoever, and women held this mystery cult over them for millennia, just the longest time. And men have been trying to dig out from under that, saying, hey, we do have spiritual capacity. And then, of course, they're being claimed now that they're you know, sexist and all that. No, that's not true at all. I insist that we all have equal capacity, ultimately, to recognize there's no specialness at all. Where all of us are freedom itself. We are freedom. Not we've developed freedom. We are freedom from the get-go. We've always been perfect freedom. Perfect freedom, the idea that perfect freedom is engaged in developing perfect freedom is total absurdity. Total absurdity, and nothing other than total absurdity. So I'm on a roll right now because it's intense, and we're in big trouble here. Again, no matter what happens going forward, we're in big trouble. I don't care what side you're on. You know, transcend being on sides right now. That's not the issue. It's not the issue ultimately. It's the word for turmoil here. There's a sinkhole that's going to open up. And you think the sinkhole discriminates what goes into what goes in? No, it sucks everything into it. Anything that's near it's going to get sucked into it. I'm wearing all white right now. It's kind of nice. I'm more and more and more, I'm just wearing all white. It's very powerful. No preference, you see. No specialness. Just white. Symbolizes clear light here. No patterns in the clothing. Occasionally I wear with white black trim to signify, yeah, we're still in the world. We still have a continuity issue. So let's be pragmatic about it. Okay, yeah, but what I'm wearing now is just all white. Everything just white. Even a white watch. I should get white glasses, but people might freak them out. I have white sunglasses. It symbolizes simplicity, purity, non-dualness. A lot of is very symbolizes spiritual truth very, very profoundly. All white like this. It's not easy to wear all white, so I gotta get used to it. It's very powerful, very evocative of real truth, of freedom, freedom. We're not enmeshed in some matrix of complexity at all. So there's no complexity to white. It's the absence of complexity, really, white, wearing all white, just shows the complete absence of all complexity. And none of my ma were white. White. Spotless white, just white. A lot of times, just white. Just this white, you know, wrapped in this white. The absence of all complexity, total absence. Absence of any scheme or schematic or esotericism or any of this complexity, total absence of it. Now the yoga girls will try to expropriate that, co-opt it. Of course they will. But it doesn't really work on them very well, does it? Not really. They can't really pull it off. You have to walk the walk too, you know, and it talk the talk, walk the walk. You have to have genuine substance here. You have to be genuine royalty here to pull off all white. Absolutely, you have to be someone who's very much a courtier in the and part of the court of the Dharma kings and queens. You absolutely need to be that, or aligned with steady determination, as Ramana puts it. Only steady determination succeeds. Nothing else succeeds. That's right. That's what you're going to hear from these great teachers. That's what you're going to hear. So I'm just helping you get used to it, passing it along. I try to resonate what they're about so you get clued into it. Most people are too afraid of these spiritual teachers. They want to avoid them. So the spiritual path is one of avoidance of the highest teaching. They want to make sure they avoid the highest teaching, which is really just the only teaching, their true teaching there is, actually. Don't call it highest, just call it non-absurdist. It's really non-absurdist teaching. There's no way around the impossibility. There's no way around that. We are freedom. We can't become freedom. We are freedom. So the gradualist path, the idea of becoming freedom, is a way of avoiding the realization we are freedom. Right? How can you have both? You can't both believe that we're becoming freedom and all at the same time believe we are freedom, already perfect freedom. Yeah, how can we believe both of those at the same time? You cannot. You cannot really do it. Now, the gradualist path, properly understood, is you're just evaporating your continuity fear, but you do that by being aware that directly, glimpsing directly, you are freedom. You're not becoming it at all. You already are it. You already are perfectly enlightened. You don't need to become enlightened. And then this causes evaporation of continuity fear. And that part is gradual, yes. So just be aware of all this. You know, be spiritually literate. I've been eating too much lately, but the scale is still kind to me, but I realize I better be careful here. Eating cashews and crackers and macaroni salad and potato salad, and it's like, uh-oh. Could easily, you know, boom, and I keep the discipline going, which is difficult for me, because, you know, you start just drinking kefir, and it's bland. you want that macaroni salad. It's too much bland food, you know, you can get tired of it. You really can. And, you know, some nice salty chips. I start to get a taste for those. So you gotta stay disciplined here. So that kale and beet smoothie is beckoning to me. That'll kill my appetite completely. Just the thought of it kills my appetite. I hope I didn't ruin your dinner with that mental image. Oh my God, that's horrible. Almost drives me to fried chicken. I actually cooked fried chicken for some other folks last night. Really nice fried chicken. You know, they almost call me the Colonel. I can really dial up some good fried chicken. Actually, grilled chicken, sorry. Grilled chicken, which is even better than fried chicken. We've done the Colonel one better here. We grill it on a Foreman grill. Comes out nice. Nice and dry and tasty. And throw some nice Major Earl's chutney or something. Or some Major somebody's chutney. Major Gray, Earl, Major Gray, or Earl Grey, some tea, but mango chutney. It's good. It's very tasty. Organic this, organic that. Oh yeah, the yoga girls will say, we'll fix what your problem is. You just haven't, you know, your food hasn't been organic enough. That's what's wrong with you. That's why you're not feeling so good. I said, I've like eaten the best diet of anyone in the world all my life, and I've never felt good. It's got nothing to do with it, really. You don't want to, you know, you want to eat well to help with the stress, but it's not really a decisive factor. It doesn't matter what I eat, I still feel stressed out. Path is stressful. Doesn't matter what you do. The continuity fear is strong. You have to evaporate it. You don't evaporate it by your eating habits or your music habits or any of that stuff. You do it by actually doing it. Full stop in the wow is required. Intensity, you know, gets very, very strong. I haven't reached the intensity yet in this talk. I mean, I'm really tired today. I haven't hardly slept at all. I just brutal struggle yesterday. This is just, I felt horrible yesterday. Maybe the aftermath of the troubles in the world, the shock, collective global shock, probably. It just hit really hard. And even though you don't pay any attention to it, it still hits, still reverberation in the psyche of the world. We're all, it's just one mind. It's not that we're all connected, it's that we all are that one mind. So, we you know, everyone's reactions, we're feeling it. We're feeling it at some level. We're feeling it. What's going on? And if we're reacting to that, if we're not seeing it's just all the same, it's just sameness, then, well, you know, we're going to be shaken up, rocked by it. So I was really rocked by it. I was also very tired from running. I did my jog, I actually ran fast. It's like that shift into another higher gear of, I really, on the downhill portion, I really ran and really was really striding and running. It's like, wow, that's a whole different thing than jogging. And all the rubber band exercise I'm doing, it just, you know, it's really hitting my upper body. I'm sore, I'm tired. It was really, everything hit at once. My diet changed. So sometimes you get this convergence, you get hit all at once. And then just like, oh, wow. It's really tough. I couldn't sleep. Had to get up early. It was brutal, just brutal. But today I still exercised. I still put myself through everything, and I just tried to, you know, gut it out, and I did. Didn't have to drink any caffeine. It was amazing. I don't know. I took a half an hour of sleep, rested for a half an hour. That helped me get through. You know, I'm still functioning, but it may be too much for me to have like an intense wow at this point. But I'm sure what I've said is enough to generate quite a bit of wow for the audience here. See, I can be a Dharma prince. I will be a Dharma prince. I am already a Dharma prince. Absolutely. It's just has a nice ring to it, right? Dharma prince. Dharma, I mean spiritual teaching, effective spiritual teaching, real spiritual teaching. I'm a prince of that. Absolutely. That's accurate. I'm a Dharma prince. Serving the Dharma kings and queens, the royal Dharma royalty. So I can be a Dharma prince. I will be a Dharma prince. I already am a Dharma prince. That's a wow. That's a big wow. So I guess I did produce a wow. almost 2 hours here of working on this, huh? Great. So I talked to some feisty guys, you know. They don't know what to do about it. You know, they're not whipped yet, but they're saying, man, you know, I'm doomed. I'm doomed. I mean, the guys I speak with, they just say, hey, I'm doomed. It's plain and simple. But they're still feisty, you know. And they thank me for the conversation, you know, because I listen to them. You know, what they say doesn't shock me at all. They, you know, they tell it like it is. They say, this is just, what's going on is just completely insane. And I say, yeah, it is. Absolutely it is. You know, guy talked to me today. He said, look, Trump, you know, people hate him. He's this and that. I don't, you know, might say some things I don't like, whatever. He says, but, you know, he's a realist. He's a realist. He's a realist. He's a pragmatist. Realist, and he tells it like he's not afraid to tell it like it is. And I said, that's true. And I said, look, Trump doesn't bother me. He says, no, and he said, that doesn't bother me either. It doesn't bother me. I don't have to agree with everything he says at all, but he doesn't bother me the way that people are like so freaked out about him. They think he's the Antichrist. You know, it's just like they completely, they're turning it, going berserk. They're going berserkers. They're letting him, you know, this shows us extreme instability in their psyche for this. I mean, I never came unglued when this present guy in the White House dude, you know, the first dude, was elected. I already looked into his mind. I saw where he's at, and I say he's a great deceiver, plain and simple. Okay, we'll just have to deal with it. He's a liar. He's a deceiver, and he thinks he can get away with it. He thinks he's very clever about, he can fool just about everybody, and you know, that's his mindset. So I say, okay, but I didn't come unglued. Yeah, don't like it. He's still perfect. He's a brother of perfection, just like everyone else. So is Trump. He's his brother of perfection. We're all brothers and sisters. We're all spiritual royalty, by the way. Every single one of us is the highest spiritual royalty. Every single one of us. Plain and simple. No exceptions to anyone. No exceptions. Period. Never will there ever be an exception to that fact. Everything that God created is absolutely perfect. The idea that souls are going to be destroyed is the biggest nonsense ever. Everything that God created is absolutely perfect. And there's no exception to that whatsoever. It will always be so. So, might as well get used to that fact. So, you know, so this is how I see it. So, I'm not bothered by the, you know, whoever, this and this and that. But, you know, I just... doesn't bother me. I'm not bothered by Trump. I'm not bothered. But most a lot of people are just like, they go insane. They literally, you take a nice person, they turn into a murderer. I mean, if they think they had the opportunity, they would kill him. This is what most people are like. A lot of people are like that now. You talk about instability, spiritual instability. It's just ridiculous. It's just ridiculous. If I was the first dude on a golf course or something, I'd play around, I'd shake his head, you know, treat him like spiritual royalty, just like I treat everybody like spiritual royalty. I'm not going to lose my cool, you know, lose my composure, being a Dharma prince. I'm not going to lose my Dharma princeness for that. No way. No way. What are they thinking? They're coming unglued. It's ridiculous. It's just totally shameful, you know? Totally inappropriate reactions. You know, if you don't, you could tell it like it is. If you don't like somebody, be a realist, and you could say it as a Dharma prince, you know, say it as and let it be like that. And stay in the state of all goodness, so to speak. Not the goodness of absurdity, but the all goodness of freedom. Which transcends good and bad absurdity, really. Anything other than this pure freedom is absurdity. Really, that's all it is. That's all that it is. And that too is inherently free. There's perfect inherent freedom. In that, it's born, it arises within its own intrinsic perfect freedom and perfect spaciousness. As that, also, like everything else. Longchenpa expresses it beautifully. So let the Dharma King roar. Right? Let's hear the Dharma King roar. Absolutely. We love the roar of the Dharma King and Queens. The Dharma Kings and Queens. Let them roar. And we just bask in that roar. Others, you know, the yoga girl, they head for the hills like cockroaches. But we bask in the roar of that. Let's hear the roar. We bask in the aura of the roar of spiritual rority. Right? The core of the spiritual rority, actually. Just enjoy it. I love it. I love it. Louder the roar, the better, more music it is to my ears. heavyweights. Just imagine, this is a great skillful means. Just imagine they're just roaring, this roar of intensity. Just imagine you're experiencing that. Like a supersonic jet just flew by you at Mach 10, you know. the roar is just like, ah, yeah, that's great. The wow of that. Just imagine the wow of that. And instead of freaking out, you're just like, I love it. I love it. Come fly with me. Beyond the Sea, Bobby Darin. That could be a term. It's a very spiritual song. My love is waiting for you. I'll never go sailing again. No more sailing. No more sailing. No more sailing away from our freedom. Our true love is our freedom. You know, no more sailing. Bobby Darin, great singer, great entertainer, actually. Him and Dion, the kings back then, really. They both of them were fabulous. Dion still is fabulous. Elvis is fabulous, too. But, I mean, these guys had some cool to them. Bobby Darin, great singer. Great entertainer, died very young, unfortunately. But that song, Beyond the Sea, is a very, very, very famous song. But look, listen to it as a spiritual song. It's really a spiritual song. He's not really talking about a yoga girl. So we go back to his, he's talking about freedom. You know, somewhere beyond the sea, right? My love is waiting for me. Beyond the sea, just beyond the sea of samsara. Our freedom is waiting for us. It's still there. And once I'm finally through with sailing, and I'm finally coming back home, and for me, that's it. No more sailing. I'm done. That's why that song resonated with people so strongly. Really, really did. And Blondie's song Dreamin' really is about freedom also. It's free, you know. It from our standpoint, freedom seems like dreaming. Okay, this is a way of metaphorically, poetically speaking about it. At whatever you dream, you can experience it. Now, experience is absolute freedom. When I met you in the restaurant, I could tell you were no debutante. You asked me, "What's my pleasure? A movie or a measure?" I said, "I'll have a cup of tea and tell you about my dreaming." Right. Let's have a cup of tea and let the Dharma kings and queens roar. The Dharma royalty roar. Roar, the roar of freedom. Let's listen to the roar of freedom. Silence is endless speech. Silence is saying everything. Let's listen to the roar of silence. Let's listen to Ramana's roar of silence. Talk about a lion roaring, right? It's right there. Hang out in that roar. The Aurora Borealis. The Aurora Freedom Alice. So you might feel like you're out of shape, you've been working out, dieting. I feel terrible that I said getting fat, I'm so fat, you know, I look at the scale, it's still okay, but sometimes you feel down because you're working so hard, but you're actually improving, what I'm doing is strengthening me ultimately, but as you keep working out every day, you always feel lousy, right? I don't rest on your laurels, but you know someday, you know I can feel the poise is, you know, I could just feel it's sort of it's getting better actually, working on my core, keep working on your core. I did 100 of these working on my core today. That's the most I've done. And it's, you know, it's painful, it's difficult, but it strengthens your. One thing I notice a difference, like I can swing on the golf club, the next day my back isn't sore. I don't have back pain. This is a sign my core is getting stronger. I don't have hip pain anymore. That's really quite extraordinary. I used to always suffer from repercussions. Now, I don't. My muscles are tired and sore, but I don't have this pain. You're like, oh, something's wrong with my back, or so. There's really, no, I don't. I really don't. It's amazing. So I'm not suffering the severe repercussions like I used to, because overall, you know, greater strength, fitness, stability, balance, all this stuff is better. Everything's better. So spiritually also, everything's better, actually. It's better. It's much better. I'm getting all these glimpses. I put a new entry in my blog. I really highly recommend going to that blog. I'm putting gems in there for you. This is skillful practice there. Everything I do, the videos, everything is so for you to use a skillful practice, skillful means. And in the blog, I put Longchenpa's advice. I got a lot of advice. There's another skillful means I will explain to you. Maybe I'll explain on the blog and you can go to there and read it and understand. And I'll put some links on there. I'll put it on the blog. The blog is becoming a very important aspect here of helping this world. Because you can go and read there and do it quickly. So I will keep working on the blog for you. I highly advise. So far, nobody's gone to view it, as far as I can tell. There's been zero comments. All the blogs I've had, everything I've done, I've had zero comments. Zero comments. Zero likes, zero comments. And no one's viewing it. It's just incredible. The amount of work I've put in and the lack of response is just astonishing here. But, you know, I keep working, making it better. Making it better, you need skillful means. There's ways to limit your vulnerability to the superficiality that's coming, spiritual superficiality in the yoga girl culture. There's ways to limit your exposure, your vulnerability to that. And so what can I say? Except I give the highest urgency to use these means and work at it, like you're working out. You know, got to take it really seriously. You want to be in the court of the Dharma kings and queens. You better practice. And you better use skillful means. That's what it's all about. So there's some links I can give you. There's a technique I can give you that actually uses Facebook in a very helpful way. I found a way to use Facebook in a very helpful way. And it's not what you think. It's extraordinary, actually. I discovered it, and you could do this. Anyone can do it. And you come away, your mind will just be like blown. It's like, wow, this is just extraordinary. So I highly recommend visiting the blog and linking to it in some way, right? I mean, I used to visit blogs every day. Some people had blogs that I like. I'd visit them every single day. I'd look forward to visiting their blog and seeing what their newest entry was. Absolutely, I did. But, I mean, I've got to have some feedback. You know, if people just like it, say, hey, I like it. Even a comment like, this is helping me. I don't get any comments from people saying, this is helping me. So it's really weird. You know, it's weird. I think people are too scared, you know, thinking that, but you know what? You're in the court of the Dharma kings and queens. You can't be scared like that. They'll protect you. You know, their roar will protect you. You've got to feel that way. Otherwise, you're going to chicken out for sure. And then that's what they want. They want you to chicken out. They want to intimidate you. They want you to feel like, you know, they're going to get you. But I think people are really scared right now. They're too afraid. I see. It's not just me. It's everywhere. I go visiting all sorts of blogs and spiritual stuff. Nobody's commenting. I can't believe it. I just say, wow, everyone's too scared to speak up. To be identified with in any way now. They don't want to be identified. They don't want to be caught. So they're pretending to be very superficial, but that's not going to work. It's not going to work. Because when you go that direction, then they'll assume, oh, okay, you're superficial, so you're going to do what we tell you to do, and you're going to go into that sinkhole. Because you got to keep pretending even more than you have to show that you're 100%er, and you're all in to absurdity. Like you're 100% absurdist. And then you're going to have a mental breakdown when that happens, because you don't really want to do that. And you say, oh, I'm in big trouble now. So that's what the Dharma kings and queens know about this, and the Dharma princes will help out, and we've got your back, but you better start practicing. You're not going to ever hear anything different in the court of the Dharma kings and queens, is you better start practicing. That's all you're going to hear. Really. And that's what I do. After taping here for 2.5 hours, I'm going to go in there and I'm going to start doing something for another 5 hours tonight, or, 2 o'clock in the morning, whatever, how much time I have. I don't know. What time is it? It's like 9 o'clock. Well, I'm going to hit it for another 3 hours probably, right? Absolutely, I am. After taping all day today, driving, taping, and doing this, video, and it's nonstop. It's nonstop now. How can we stop right now? World's on fire. How can we stop? Our house is on fire. Who is it that's not practicing? That's absurd right now. So, even lacking all feedback, I'm still doing it. I just have to assume that there's some out there that are doing it. And it helps me out, so I'm certainly, if it's helpful for me, I'll keep doing it. It forces me to be very focused. I can't slack off if I'm going to try to deliver the goods here. If I'm saying I'm a Dharma prince, how can I slack off? I've got to bring it. You got contacted by Longchenpa. You're a Dharma prince. There's no two ways about it. It's kind of like, huh? What? I didn't know who it was. So I could, it's taken me a couple of years to realize he doesn't act capriciously in these matters, It's like, oh, wow. So it's a responsibility. It's a big responsibility. So again, say, I can be a Dharma prince. I will be a Dharma prince. I already am a Dharma prince. Or you could say princess. Right? Right? Sure. Why not? I can be a Dharma princess. I will be a Dharma princess. I already am a Dharma princess. And someday you'll be a Dharma queen or a Dharma king. Absolutely you will. We already are that. In fact, we are that already. All of us. And ultimately we're beyond the gender. But while we're, still in this, whatever you want to call it, we can differentiate that if you want to. What I hate is this, he, she thing. And I don't go for that. I mean, let's not overdo it, okay? Dharma princess doesn't need that kind of stuff. Does not. She knows where it's at. Okay. Yes, the yoga girls love that though. He, she, everything it says, has to be bracketed he, she. Eventually it'll be she, he, and then eventually it'll be just she. There's no question about it. They'll do that and think, you see, we finally got it right. We're finally back to the mystery of it all. Only the feminine can know the mystery of it all. Only them are really, truly in tune with creating life. The men just, they can't create life. They can only serve it. Of course, bodies aren't life. So get over it. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Thank you, Jesus Christ. And we're headed towards Good Friday tomorrow. A couple of guys, I wished them, hey, have a great, happy Easter, Guy shook my hand today. He was a real curmudgeon, but he wished me well. There's goodness in him. I refuse to be fooled by his, act. Happy Easter. Have a great Easter. Shook his hand, I'm shaking hands with people, and saying, hey, I'm not beaten. I'm not beaten. They can tell that I've got something in me that, he joked, said, people think you're weird. I said, I'm different. And he goes, I am too. We're all different, right? What a nasty place it would be, right, if we were all exactly the same in terms of just our expression. And, we can joke each other and stuff. It's fine. So, you know, maybe I'm different, that I'm not whipped, I'm not beaten. There's something in me that is defiant, more than defiant. I'm a Dharma prince. You know, that's more than defiance. There's something different than defiance there. And I think people can feel that. I just say, huh, you know. I told them, hey, yeah, we're doomed, but we'll find some other option. That's what we'll do. We'll have to, you know, we'll come up with some other option. But we're, you know, we're the scapegoats. We're the scapegoats. There's no question about it. And if you want to be an indentured servant, slave of the yoga girls, then you, they'll put up with you for a while, But when they clean house, it's thorough. Keep in mind, the Fräuleins of Germany were very responsible for Nazism. They decided to be clean house and be very thorough. When you get some clean freak, is a lot of times it's a woman is cleaning house. I mean, there's not going to be a speck of dust left in that house as far as if she wants to clean house, really, there's no stone is going to be left unturned. So don't be fooled to think that these yoga girls are going to play nice. They'll play nice, get you in the pen. Once they get you in the corral, in the cattle car, then, you know, that's it. That's taps for you. And they're going to clean house. Okay, and when they clean house, there's nowhere you're going to be able to hide in this world. Whatever cave you're in, they're going to find you out in that cave. They're going to get every bit of dust out of this world that they think is messing up their immaculately clean house of absurdity, which is they think is causing their paranoia. They say, well, it must be the dust, of course. Gotta get rid of that dust. That's what the problem is. And so keep in mind, you get those cleaning lady that too fanatic, right? Look out, dust. They're looking under the carpet. They're looking everywhere. They're paranoid. They're like, I'm going to find that dust, and you're going to be that part, that dust that they find. I don't care where you are, hiding in some cave in the Himalayas. They'll send a drone after you. They most certainly will. You know, drone technology is just going to absolutely devastate this world. And there's other technology. I told you about nanotechnology. They'll deliver nanotechnology through drones. All right? In the air or whatever, you breathe it in. And you'll start developing all these disformities and mental aberrations, and all your body will get all weird and stuff. And then they'll say, hey, we've set up a clinic here for antidotes. The yoga girls bringing antidotes to this terrible disease. Isn't it awful that this happened? But we're here to heal you. We're the healers. We can heal you. Of course, they're the ones that brought it to you in the first place. It's just like, it's so insane. The absurdity is so insane, actually. It's so absurd. Just say, hey, absurdity is so absurd. There's no end to the absurdity of absurdity. Keep that in mind. As long as you keep an absurd premise, there's no end to the absurdity that premise generates. And there's no way to ever corral it and ever get rid of it, no matter how much dust you get rid of. Absurdity is itself just dust and keeps generating more and more and more. And you think, oh, there's a whole universe of dust I got to get rid of. Got to figure out, get the robots working on it. Yeah. Now, but the yoga girls are still very intimidating. I mean, I say, hey, I just stay away from them. You know, I still feel like, oh, you know, they can get to me. Because they're very confident. They're saying, we're going to clean house, you know, and everything's going to be great. And you think, oh, thank you, yoga girls. I really need to have the house clean. That'd be nice spick and span. And you know, they're just so gung-ho. You get attracted by that gung-ho-ness. They're 100%ers. But yeah, their purpose, they're going to clean house and make sure there's no truth here anywhere. It's all superficial. The dust of truth, as they see it, is all, they're going to dust all the truth out of here. So everything seems immaculately superficial and absurd. So there is that attraction to that gung-ho-ness, and we can get it done. We're going to get it done. And the confidence they have, they're very confident. And they just say that my body is perfect. You know, my superficiality is perfect. There's no absurdity in my superficiality. It's perfect absurdity. You know, Look at me. I'm hear me roar. I'm yoga girl. Hear me roar. I'm perfect absurdity. I've mastered absurdity. I'm the master of absurdity, or the mistress of absurdity. You know. And you're gonna love it. You're gonna love my absurdity. You're gonna fall in love with my absurdity. There's no question. They have no doubt about it in their minds. It's like they have no doubt. Like I'm just too much awesome for you for sure. Too much awesome absurdity for you. So it's very hypnotic and spellbinding. You used to call them witches. You used to call yogas witches. They're very spellbinding what they do. I'm awesomely absurd. And you're already in love with me, you know. Your absurdity already is just irresistibly attracted to my perfect absurdity, and I know it. You can't resist. This is how they're like this. You can't resist, and I already know it. So why resistance is futile? Why even try? And they just laugh and smirk at you, like don't be silly, you silly boy. You know resistance is futile. We know that. This is their psychology. That how can absurdity resist my perfect absurdity? Well, absurdity can't resist, but I'm not absurd. So, truth most certainly can just see that it's nothing at all. But that to them doesn't register at all. It doesn't register at all. It just like goes right over their head. Just they keep saying, repeating, you cannot resist my perfect absurdity. You cannot resist my perfect absurdity. You're irretrievably drawn to the way the moth is drawn to a flame. You have no resistance. Resistance is futile. Resistance is futile. This is like a mantra they constantly are putting out. Resistance is futile. You can't resist. You cannot resist. You cannot resist superficiality. I have perfect, awesome, absurd superficiality, and you love it. Because I know you're superficial. I love it, and you can't resist. You love it. You love it too. You're helpless to resist. This is their mantra. This is their practice. This is their mindset. And you know, super seductive, isn't it? So you know, stay away. Stay away from Run Around Sue for sure. Like Dion sang, I recommend that song. I got a song list of stuff. I don't know if it's in there. I think it is. Run Around Sue. Yeah, Dion was a great singer back then. Wow. You talk about a belter. You talk about someone that's just... You talk about a rock voice. Oh, my gosh. Run Around Sue. You listen to it now, it just holds up like a diamond. I mean, it's just a powerful song. Wanderer, too, which is it's kind of the reverse of that. I'm not going to... You know, so... Keep away from Run Around Sue. Absolutely. The best strategy is keep away from the yoga girls. All right. Don't think you can handle it, because they won't stop saying that you can't. Your resistance is futile. They believe it. And they'll just keep hitting you with that, and keep it hitting you with that, and keep hitting you with that. And that's all. They might be listening to your spiritual spiel, but mentally, physically, emotionally, their psyche, they're just hitting with you with resistance is futile. Resistance is futile. Mentally, telepathically, psychically, they're chanting this to you. They're chanting this like an enchanter, like a siren. So they, on the surface, they may be acting like, oh, you know, I'm spiritual aspirant, I'm a devotee, I want to know truth, and blah, blah, blah. But psychically, they're repeating over and over that resistance is futile. You can't resist me. You can't resist me. It's impossible. You can't resist me. They call it love magic. They call it magic. It's psychic, telepathic magic they use on you. Very dangerous stuff. Very, very dangerous. And this is what they've been practicing this for a long time. This has been going on for quite some time. It really started in the 70s very strongly with cocaine that loosened their inhibitions to get into magic, witchery, actually, full blast. And they on cocaine, they said, what the heck, you know, I don't care, I'm just going to go for it. Kind of blasted them into that downward spiral that they're on. And so they've been studying that stuff very, very seriously. I mean, women are so into sex magic. It's just they're maniacs about it, actually. Maniacs about it. What they're thinking about will make any man blush, you know. I mean, they're notorious for it, actually. And this is a psychic thing that they're doing. It's a psychic thing. And they target you psychically. So stay away from that stuff. Stay away from it. I don't care what the superficial situation seems like. You know, they're witches, plain and simple. Very, very, very dangerous witchery with this magic, sex magic, drug magic, all this stuff, music magic. You know, they'll put you under a spell. They most certainly will. And, you know, good luck getting out of that. Because it doesn't occur to you, and then to do this, to do the radical Dzogchen, the non-dual perspective, that shift, it doesn't occur to you. And so you try to then do it on merit, and then you're snared. And then your mind is just starts getting into all complexity. It's horrible. It's horrible. Stay away from drugs. That's one of their key things that they use, one of the key instruments that they use. Animals, too. Familiars, they call it. They use animals. They use drugs, they use music, they use sex, and you know, those are the main things they use. They use some other stuff too, spiritual accoutrement accessories, but they're bad news, okay? Stay away from running around Sue. Just stay in the grace of the Dharma royalties roar. Keep getting used to that roar. That is protection for you. Keep getting used to that roar. So visit the blog, I'll put a link on it for you, and I'll keep posting great stuff here. And, you know, if you don't comment, no feedback, okay.